Okay. Oh, is it time?
Oh, jeez.
I'm having too much fun, everybody. I'm having too much fun. Well, good morning, everybody. And if you're watching online, I want to welcome you as well to our services this morning. But I want to especially welcome those who are here and those who are out in the lobby having too good of a time. We constantly talk about this on Tuesday mornings, about how good of a time you're having out there and how we can get people in here, which we also think is a good time. Anyways, my name is Travis. I'm the lead pastor here at Canyon Creek. If you are visiting us, if you're new or you have any questions, I'll hang out up here at the end of the service. Would love to connect with you. Would love to get to meet with you, maybe even set up an opportunity to grab some coffee or spend some time together. Would love to do that with you. I have entered into the Thanksgiving mode. Vacation has already started for me this week because it's sort of the fall break for students, and so it's a great opportunity for me to hang out with my kids, family during this week, so it's a nice week to take off, and so I'm excited for Thanksgiving. I started my Thanksgiving celebration by going out to Watsonville. There's a place called Coralitos Meat Market, and they sell turkeys that we love, and so I went and got my fresh turkey. That's in the fridge. I went to one of my favorite breakfast places, and I was alone for all of it, which was wonderful. And it was great for me just to prepare my heart for the Thanksgiving season, which I think is a good thing to do. Here at Canyon Creek for the month, we are trying just to celebrate being thankful. Even when we don't necessarily want to be thankful, how do we get to that place where we can recognize that we are so blessed in our relationship with the Lord, that there is always something to be thankful for, even if we're in the midst of difficult times. And so our hope is, as we are coming together here for worship, that we can deeply sense God's love for us, the hope that He's given to us through the work of His Son, and that we can come together every week to celebrate as a church, that we are called into worship with one another to celebrate the work of the Son on the cross and the new life that He offers every single one of you. So, would you stand with me, and we'll do our call to worship together, and then we'll go right into song. I will read the pastor part, and you will read the church part. Shout for joy in the Lord, O you righteous. Praise befits the upright. Sing to Him a new song. Play skillfully on the strings with loud shouts. Let's sing.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see a mountain moved. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me, yeah. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God.
Well, to continue my story, I'm having a wonderful Saturday, enjoying my breakfast at my favorite breakfast spot out there, Watsonville, Aptos, Santa Cruz area. And then all of a sudden, I'm informed that one of my children decided to have a boxing match with my car and our garage door. So that wasn't pretty. Please do not flood him. I won't tell you which one, although maybe it'd be obvious, but neither the house nor the car won, and it was a moment for sure. So I'm sitting there enjoying my Thanksgiving seasonness, and all of a sudden I'm like, oh, goodness gracious. So I quickly finish my food, jump in the vehicle, and they start sending me pictures of what it's looking like, and I'll even tell you what was wild. I get these few pictures of the car damage and the garage door damage, and I'm also driving back over Highway 17. Ooh, people are terrible drivers. It just blows my mind. I'm sorry for being critical, but I'm in my 50s now, and that's what you do when you're in your 50s. You get a little critical when people make mistakes with their car. So I'm recognizing all these accidents. There's at least three. I'm not even kidding you. Like three on the way there, and I saw three on the way back. I'm like, my goodness. But I'm sitting there going, Lord, thank you for this, because this is sort of what it's like, isn't it? We have this great joy, this great hope, this great Lord that fills us up and gives us this wonderful life to live, but we just find ways to have little mess-ups all over the place, don't we? Now, Paul talks about this. We fight inside of ourselves. We don't want to sin. We don't want the accidents, but they sure do come, don't they? And we all recognize that, and then that kind of creates all kinds of stuff inside of us. Could be anger, frustration, all of these things. But here's the beauty of all of it, is that we do not need to avoid the accidents and the mistakes and the pain of sin. We don't have to pretend like they didn't happen. And so in that moment, I could be sitting there having my breakfast and trying to be in this place of Thanksgiving, and then all of a sudden there's something to deal with. I don't have to run away from it. I don't have to pretend like it didn't happen. Turn off my phone. I don't want to hear from you right now. No, I can get my stuff, jump in my vehicle, and I can head towards it to deal with it, to work with it, to resolve it. Because I've been empowered by a God who's given me the ability to do that. A Lord who says, don't hide, and don't run away. And even if you attempt to do so, it's a foolish endeavor because I am everywhere. And so this is part of the joy that we have. This is part of the thanksgiving that we have in our hearts, is knowing that we can come to the Lord with our accidents and our mistakes. So I want to read this prayer to you, and for you just to reflect on it. You can close your eyes while I'm saying these words and let them sink in. You could follow along on the screen as I read this prayer of confession over you. This comes from Psalm 33. It's based on Psalm 33. Our call to worship was the first four verses of Psalm 33, and Psalm 33 is about a wonderful God who's created everything for us. He also recognizes our failure in creation, and then we'll see by the end how he meets us in the midst of his sovereign will to restore us. But hear this prayer of confession of sin as I read it over you. Heavenly Father, you love righteousness and justice. The earth is full of your unfailing love. Yet we confess that we have not reflected your righteousness in our lives, instead neglecting justice and mercy in our dealings with others. You, Lord, created the heavens by your word and all their starry host by the breath of your mouth. In the magnificence of your creation, we have failed to acknowledge your power and majesty, often living as though you are far removed from the workings of this world. You gather the waters of the sea into jars. You put the deep into storehouses. Despite this display of your sovereignty over creation, we have doubted your ability to provide for our needs, relying instead on our limited understanding and resources. Your plans stand firm forever, and the purpose of your heart through all generations. Yet we have been arrogant and prideful, often making plans without seeking your will, presumptuously thinking we know better than you. You look down from heaven and see all mankind. You form the hearts of all and consider everything they do. We acknowledge our sins before you, knowing that nothing is hidden from your sight. We have sinned in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. No king is saved by the size of his army. No warrior escapes by his great strength. We confess our misplaced trust in human power and ingenuity. We have often relied on our abilities, forgetting that our true strength lies in your grace and power. So forgive us, O Lord, for our sins. Renew a right spirit within us and lead us back towards righteousness. May we live as people who not only acknowledge your sovereignty, but also joyfully submit to it. In your mercy, restore us and guide us that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. And the church said, amen. And so I get home, disaster everywhere. We start just putting the pieces together back one at a time. Dry some tears, calm some hearts, some frazzled emotions. And we looked at the car and made some plans for it to go to the shop to get fixed and worked on. We actually looked at the damage to the house, and most of it was actually work we were able to do on our own. We were able to get some boards removed from the side of the house, clean them up, put them back together, put them back onto the house where they belonged, put some facade back up, and recognize the damage was not as great as we had thought. that things can be repaired. Certainly, the paint isn't quite as crisp as it used to be, and there are markings, there are scars, there are wounds, but in some ways, they reflect a beauty to a story underneath all of the happenings. And we can recognize, I could recognize for myself on this Saturday of trying to build Thanksgiving in my heart, that we can live in an assurance that God is actively doing this work in each one of us, that he's putting us back together. He's working through our mistakes and our sufferings and our silliness, and he's putting us back together, not always perfectly, and we're going to have the next disaster the next day and the day after and the day after, but God will be there, ready to gently restore us and to love us. But we also walk with this huge assurance, this deep assurance that it won't always be like this. That there will be a day when all things will be made new and all things will be made right. And it's because of this assurance that we can be thankful, filled with gratitude, and filled with joy. So I would love to end this time of reflecting on our confession and assurance by doing a reading with you where you respond again. So please stand with me and let's recite this and then again go into song. I'll read the pastor part, you could read the church part. Our soul waits for the Lord, he is our help and our shield. The unfailing love of the Lord surrounds those who trust in him. Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope in you. As we have confessed our sins, so let us receive his grace. Amen. All right, friends, let's sing.
Fear no foe,
with thee at hand to bless. Ills have no end, tears lose their bitterness. Yes, where is thy sting, death? Where grave thy victory? I triumph still, abide in me. Hold thou thy cross before my closing eyes. Shine through the gloom and point me to the skies. Heaven morning breaks and earth's faint shadows flee. In life, in death, Lord, abide with me. In life, in death, Lord, abide with me.
Amen. You can be seated.
Hello. There we go. Good morning, Canyon Creek. Happy Thanksgiving. My name is Jenny Hung, and I will be doing our announcements today. But first, I want to welcome anyone who is visiting for the first time, especially if you're traveling here for Thanksgiving or you started attending recently. We would love to get to know you better, and we would love for you to get to know us better. And the best way to do that would be to take a minute to fill out the welcome card that's in the seat back, and you can drop it off in the offering box, or you can scan the code in the seat in front of you and then click on the button that says New to Canyon Creek. And now for our announcements. The first one is Savor the Season Christmas Tea. All you ladies, 7 years and up, you are cordially invited to our Savor the Season Annual Women's Christmas Tea on December the 2nd from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. in the Gathering Hall. This year's theme is the invitation, and our Canyon Creek's very own Lisa Raymond will be our guest speaker, reminding us of the most important invitation we will receive throughout the Christmas season, followed by some festive music by the Monta Vista's barbershop and beauty shop singers. Seating is limited, so please sign up soon, and registration will close after November 26. Our second announcement is our Advent Wreath and Gingerbread House Build Potluck Luncheon. For all our families and everybody attending, we would love you to have you come and gather with our church family to celebrate Advent of Jesus' birthday season on Sunday, December 3rd, right after the service for our Advent Potluck Luncheon. Christmas wreaths kits can be are available for purchase for $15 on the registration form, and you can also bring your own gingerbread house. We recommend the pre-built gingerbread houses and pre-mixed icing kits, so we don't have to wait for them to dry and build. We will be providing lasagna, hot dogs, and salad, and if you could bring your favorite potluck side dish to share, that would be wonderful. And our very last announcement, also just in the holiday season, our Harbor House toy drive for the Harbor House Christmas store. We are collecting new and unwrapped toys and gifts for all ages to donate to the Harbor House Christmas store, which is an empowering opportunity for parents from the community to select toys for their children purchased at a greatly reduced price and experience the joy of watching their children open a gift that they have chosen on Christmas morning. All proceeds raised at the store provide financial assistance for families with urgent needs. All donations can be dropped off in the church lobby or the Little Bridges office by Friday, December the 8th. You can also shop on their Amazon wish list and have the gifts sent directly to Harbor House. So if you want to take the next steps for any of these announcements, you can use the QR code or visit our church website for more information or to get signed up. And at this point, I'll invite Pastor Travis back up, and we will have new members and baptisms.
Thank you, Janie, so much. It's wonderful, and I'll invite everyone to come up now. As they're coming up, Let me just share with you a little bit of our practices here at Canyon Creek. About twice a year, we'll do more if necessary, but at least twice a year is what proves to be right. We have a class called the Basics Class, and this is our new membership class. It occurs on a Saturday. The pastors will meet with those who would like to become new church members and be a part of our community in a new way. Basically, it's practicing what you would find in Hebrews 13, where it discusses this idea of putting yourself under the submittance of leaders and submitting yourself to leaders, elders of the church. And so new membership is maybe best likened to the process of going from being a renter to being a homeowner. Both enjoy where they live, and they can create wonderful memories, and they have their address where they get their mail, and they make friends with neighbors, and they have a connection, and they thrive, and they grow, and both are great. But that difference of when you're a homeowner, when things happen to the home, they're 100% your responsibility, and you're saying to the bank or your lender, hey, I am fully prepared to tackle the problems that happen to this home. I realize they're my obligation. And when you become a member, you're signing up to say, yeah, Canyon Creek now is my obligation. It's a joyful obligation, hopefully, but it's an obligation where I am saying to myself, as things occur at this church body, I want to be a part of the vote. I want to be a part of the process. I want to be a part of making sure that this community continues to honor the Lord in all things and have a significant witness to the valley. And I'm pushing my chips in on that decision. And so these are friends of mine behind me here who have made this decision and commitment. And the final part of that is standing before all of you, answering a series of questions, answers they have given time and again to elders, to one another, to their family members and their friends. These questions are just basically affirming to all of us that they know the Lord as their Lord and Savior, that their hope rests in the work of Jesus Christ, in his life, in his death on the cross, and his resurrection, that he is their hope. They are affirming that God's word is the standard upon which they live by, and dedication to their church. And so, I'm going to do my best here to introduce everybody. I stick with first names because I'm a wise guy. I also have a little bit of a stutter. You're here long enough, you will hear that from me a little bit. And so it's better and easier for everybody as I stick with first names. So I will see how I do lining everybody up here. But I want to introduce you to Dave and Shirley both. And excited for the two of you to join us in membership. And I want to introduce you to Artano and Yvonne. And we're doing some baptisms as well, so we're excited about that. And then Alex and Melissa, I'd like to introduce you to them, and then also to Elizabeth. And so these are our new members. Love for you to greet them after the service, get to know them. We have enjoyed you all tremendously. I'm excited about you guys jumping into the life of this church. I think you will. And would love to see this be the beginning of jumping in as one of the first steps and then watching what the Lord does with you and through you here at Canyon Creek. And so, like we talked about in the membership class, I'm going to ask you some questions. Unless something is radically different for you, the answer will simply be yes or I do. All right? And so, so please hear these questions and then answer together. First, do you acknowledge yourselves to be sinners in the sight of God, justly deserving his displeasure, and without hope, save in his sovereign mercy? Do you? Wonderful. Second, do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Son of God and Savior of sinners? And do you receive and rest upon him alone for salvation as he is offered in the gospel? Do you? Wonderful. Number three, do you now resolve and promise in humble reliance upon the grace of the Holy Spirit that you will endeavor to live as becomes the followers of Christ? Do you? Yes. Do you promise to support the church in its work and worship to the best of your ability? And then finally, do you submit yourselves to the government and discipline of the church and promise to study its purity and peace? Do you? Wonderful. Let me pray for them. Father God, we thank you for our brothers and sisters who stand up here to declare their love for you and their faithfulness to you in their lives. We would ask that you would bless their time here at Canyon Creek, that you would help them be filled up, and that you would give them a sense of your call for their life, that they would be in a position to grow and strengthen that call that you have upon them, and that they would be able to serve and care and love for one another as they are here for as long as you have them here. So we pray for them, Father God. Amen. Awesome. Thank you. All right. Here's what I'm going to do. If you're not getting baptized or part of a baptized family, I'll let you guys go have a seat because we'll be here for a little bit. So you guys go and have a seat there. But the four of you and your whole clan, you're staying right here. Very good. Awesome. All right. I have my names down here. We are now going to be baptizing four children. As a church, we've gone through a sermon series recently on this, and what we recognize is this. It is a call of obedience laid upon Christians to bring their children before the Lord, to bring them before her people, and to have them baptized. This baptism does not signify a saving faith for them, but instead it signifies entering into a covenant relationship with the church, that the Lord invites them into the visible church, and that we as a church have a responsibility towards their children. They are a part of us. They are officially a part of us. And our hope and desire is the work that begins today in their baptism will find its full fruition as they grow and they mature, that they would come to a saving faith in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, and that they'll have a day in which they can come to the communion table and they can celebrate and they can be filled with vibrance and life that the Lord offers. And so this is a beginning process. It's a process where we as a church offer our dedication in raising up these children to know the Lord. So we'll have a part of response in this process. And as far as you as parents, I have some more questions for you here first about your dedication to this process and what you're doing in the raising of your children. So again, I'll read the question and simply ask that you would respond with I do or I will, whatever's appropriate. And again, these are questions we've already talked about. So first, do you acknowledge your child's need of the cleansing blood of Jesus Christ and the renewing grace of the Holy Spirit? Second, do you claim God's covenant promises on their behalf, and do you look in faith to the Lord Jesus Christ for their salvation as you have your own? Do you now unreservedly dedicate your child to God and promise in humble reliance upon divine grace that you will endeavor for them and set for them a godly example, that you will pray with them, that you will teach them the doctrines of our holy religion, and that you will strive by all the means of God's appointment to bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord? Wonderful. And then, congregation, I will ask you, do you as a congregation undertake the responsibility of assisting these parents in the Christian nurture of their children? Wonderful. Okay. So here we go. We'll start with Chloe and Callista. Where are you girls? Come on up here. All right. And I'm just going to set this down. How are we doing, girls? Okay, I'm going to take a knee right here and hang out with you. I don't want to freak you out, though, because Pastor Travis can be freaky. Okay. All right, Chloe. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Chloe, we thank you for your life. And we thank you for the joy that you bring your parents. And we hope upon hope that you, as you grow here at Canyon Creek, will grow in your faith and you'll come to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and that you will see the joy that he can bring your life as he has brought your parents. I pray this in your son's name. Amen. Great job. All right, Callista, here we go. Be gentle. Father God, thank you for Callista and her life. I pray in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit that you would grow her and mature her and bring her into full faith with you. Bless her as she grows in knowledge and strength with her parents. I pray in your son's name. Amen. Good job. Okay. Awesome. Thanks, Kid. All right. All right. Here we go. All right. Zachary, how you doing, bud? Awesome. All right, Zachary, it's my honor to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Father God, thank you for Zachary and his life, and we ask, God, that you would also continue to grow him and mature him and develop the things that he's already learned about you, God. Let them come to full fruition where they change his heart and they change his mind, and they lead him to that joy of knowing you as his Lord and Savior. Father God, let us be a church that leads and guides him and helps him to grow in you. I pray in your Son's name, amen. Awesome. All right, come on up here. Get my, all right, Carissa? Yeah, all right.
You're gonna stay down.
All right, I'm going to stay down. Oh, I guess I could stand now. All right, I've been, Carissa, you're at my eye level. That's so wonderful. All right. Carissa, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I baptize you. Carissa, we thank you for your life and just the joy you bring, Mom and Dad. We would ask that you would come to that place where you would be fully known by the Lord and he would fully know you, that you will grow in your faith and mature in your faith. And we pray for the work of this church in guiding you, instructing you, and encouraging you. And Father God, just be with this young one and lead her to know you. I pray in your Son's name, amen. Awesome. Thank you all so much. Let's give them a round of applause. And please get to know all of them after the service. Stay, have a donut, and connect with them. This really is kind of the best of all Sundays, is having this moment, and really do want to welcome all of you. And I'm just happy I got all the names correct, because that's the scariest part. And so now, why don't you all get to know each other's names a little bit better? Let's stand up, connect with one another. If you are a child in Sunday school, in elementary, you can go now. Junior high and high school, you're staying in the service as your leaders are at camp. All right. Okay.
right, good people. As the lighting indicates, the intermission is over. And so thanks for greeting each other so warmly and welcoming each other in such a nice way. We're going to listen to our scripture reader at this time. Great. Thank you all. Rich.
Hello, I'm Rich Colbert. Today's reading is from Habakkuk 2, 6 through 8. Shall not all these take up their taunt against him with scoffing and riddles for him and say, woe to him who heaps up what is not his own. For how long? And loads himself with pledges. Will not your debtors suddenly arise, and those awake who will make you tremble? Then you will be spoil for them. Because you have plundered many nations, and the remnant of the peoples shall plunder you. For the blood of man and violence to the earth, to cities and all who dwell in them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks, Rich. All right, we're going to do something a little bit different here, but I know how loving and compliant you all are. And so I know you'll go along with me. I want you to memorize this verse. It's the last verse of chapter 2 of the section that we're going to be looking at today. And it goes like this, but, and you have to put that in there. You have to sing but a little bit. But the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth, that's all the people, keep silence. Note, it does not say keep silent. That would be something you could force people to do. But that is not what this verse is telling you. It's basically saying, I want you to practice something which we're going to entitle silence. More on that later. Keep silence before him. But instead of what's going on, the Lord, Yahweh, is in his holy temple. Where's that? Where's this holy temple? It's not a building on this earth. His presence indwelt the temple when it was on earth, Solomon's temple. But that's not where his holy temple is right now. His holy temple is not on this earth. His holy temple is not in the immediate planets around us. Where is his holy temple? His holy temple has to be bigger than the cosmos. The creator of all things is bigger than the cosmos, the universe that we're so dumbfounded by. Where is his holy temple? Where is this presence of God? It's beyond it all. It's infinite and beyond your understanding. He's saying, but the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silent before him. Say it out loud with me. Start the memory work here. But the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. How many of you are great at memory verses? Let's see if you can look at it only halftime. We'll do it again. But the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. We'll do it just one more time, and then I'm going to leave you alone. But don't look at the screen. Here we go. But the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the... Oh, you got it. All right, we'll come back to it. That's how this passage ends. The Lord has given his prophets, multiple prophets. Habakkuk is just one who has the same message. And the message is a horrible one. It's harsh. Nobody wants to hear it. You're about to be wiped out, Judah. Not just a little wiped out. You're about to be dominated by a power greater than you. Zephaniah, the next book in the Bible, has the same story. Go to Jeremiah, and you'll see it in a lengthy way, covering much more history. Go to Daniel, Daniel 1, and you'll see it actually happening the first time to Daniel and his people. And You have to say, you have to ask, just like Habakkuk asked, why would the Lord raise up this bitter and hasty nation? Why would the Lord do that? And you just go back. It's at the end of King. It's at the end of Deuteronomy, but it's in many different places. Joshua had the exact same fear. Moses had the exact same fear. The fear was, you go into the land, and I'm going to give you the land. I'm going to give you farms that you don't deserve to own because you didn't develop them. I'm going to give you cities that you did not build. I'm going to give you victory. And you're going to think maybe it's because you're so smart and you're so great as an army, but the victory came because I gave it to you. And so, but Joshua and Moses and the writers of Deuteronomy and the law are very fearful of this moment in Israel's history as they go into the land and then as they take up the land, because abundance is going to be handed to them. And will they keep the promise that they so carefully made? Yes, God, we will be your people. You will be our God and we will be your people. And it says there at the end of Deuteronomy, the Lord will bring a nation against you. Basically, let me read a little bit more of that passage to you. All the curses shall come upon you and pursue you and overtake you till you are destroyed because you did not obey the voice of the Lord. And so what we have here is the voice of the Lord your God will keep. You did not obey the voice of the Lord your God to keep his commandments and his statutes that he commanded you because you did not serve the Lord your God with joyfulness and gladness of heart. Because of the abundance of things. You might say, oh God, you expect an awful lot. You expect us to obey you joyfully? You expect us to give up our independence and our pride of life and our sense that we are our own creatures before all others. Instead, you want us to be servile towards you, and we're supposed to do it with happiness and gladness on our face? Instead of being thankful for what has happened to them, the gift that God has given them of a nation that's already filled with vineyards and orchards and land that's developed, God has given them that. Instead of being grateful, instead of being thankful, instead of humbly saying, this is not from me, this is from God, they refuse to recognize God. They refuse to serve him. And there's consequences to breaking your contract. There's consequences to refusing to acknowledge, humbly acknowledge who God is. There's consequences to being unthankful. And there are little things that can happen in your heart, and it can be huge things that happen in your relationship with God. So we know that judgment is coming. The prophets say it. We know why it's coming. Who is actually going to crush them, and it's the Chaldeans under Nebuchadnezzar. He's going to come, and he is. It's going to be initially in 605, and that's where Daniel gets taken off. They plunder and take the best of the gold and the best of the riches and the best of the people, and they take them back to Babylon. And then later, when the king of Israel says, no, I think I can resist, with Egypt's help, I can resist this Babylonian captivity, the city is finally wiped out to the point that we see what happened to it in Nehemiah 100 years later. Nehemiah says the walls are totally broken down and the people are miserable. And so that's what's going to happen. They're going to be crushed. Israel is going to be crushed, and this is the beginning of the time of the Gentiles. According to Scripture, fact is, God provides a glimpse into the future. He provides it to Daniel and, of all people, to Nebuchadnezzar. God gives Nebuchadnezzar, this ruler that we're about to sing a song of woe and doom about, he gives him an image, a dream. And Daniel interprets it, And God is giving Daniel and you and I and Nebuchadnezzar a glimpse of what's going to happen in the future. There's going to be Gentile nation after Gentile nation, Gentile empire after Gentile empire. It's going to start off, according to this dream, with Babylon, the head of gold. And but after that, there's going to be another one. It's going to be the Persian Empire that takes over in about 560 AD. And then it will be the Greeks at 335. The Macedonian will come in, Alexander the Great, and take over enormous parts of not only the existing empire of the Babylonians, but far more. And then in AD 31, Augustus Caesar of Rome will announce that he is Augustus, that he is next to God, that he is bumping the Godhead, and therefore everybody should call him Caesar. And that nation, that empire, that huge empire will expand from Britain to India to Egypt, to everything around the Mediterranean, as you probably know. And he's going to be the first emperor. And the western part of the empire will go for 500 years until it is wiped out by the next group of Gentiles that will come down. The eastern part, the Byzantine part, Constantinople, will last until about 1453 when it will be conquered by the Ottoman Islamic Caliphate, another huge Gentile Muslim group of people empire. And you ask, how long is this time of the Gentiles? Jesus gave us a little indication about the time of the Gentiles when he said, when he was talking about his second return, not his first coming, his second return in Luke 21, he says, Jerusalem will be trampled underfoot until the time of the Gentiles is fulfilled. Paul says in Romans 11, 25, that the softening of the hearts of Israel won't happen until the fullness of the Gentile time comes about. Successive empires of kings are going to keep happening until Christ returns to earth to reign. And if you look way at the end of the book, you're going to see Revelation 17 through 19. And guess what the great person who stands against God is called? Babylon. Of all things, this person that exemplifies Gentile refusal to recognize who God is and fights against God is the great Babylon. And so the time of the Gentiles, Habakkuk knew this. Habakkuk knew that during the time of the Gentiles, there would be successive empires that dominate until Christ returned. I don't think Habakkuk knew about Christ's return. That wasn't revealed to him, but it was certainly revealed that God had in mind a plan. Gentile empire after Gentile empire. Thousands of years going by, empire after empire, and there would be the system of hegemony, that where there would be political, economic, and military dominance or control by one state over another, and this would happen, and there would be, it takes great organization, it takes an ideology that gets spread to have an empire. There's all kinds of justifications that happen. All kinds of justifications of why we should be the dominant power in our region or in our world, and they're used as justification for all kinds of behavior. But underneath it all, there's this amazing thing that happens when you are the dominant empire in the land, in the region, in the world. Resources start pouring into you, and your land is blessed, and your coffers are filled, and all the wealth comes to you because of this powerful political dominance that you have, military dominance. And sometimes this dominance has benefit. Sometimes it has great benefit. Do you know what happened when Alexander the Great took over the world at the time? You realize that one language for the first time ever was spoken by almost all of this region that we're talking about? Greek was used to trade, was used for writing. The New Testament, along with Aramaic, was what was written in Greek so that many people could understand it. It was the common language. There are some benefits of having these giant empires that produce things that people can model and have. We think of the Pax Romana, the Peace of Rome. What happened with that? We had the Romans building roads so they could send their armies from Britain to India. Roads all over the place. And then they said, everybody's going to abide by our law. Did that help the spread of Christianity? Of course it did. Evangelism could happen all through the world because of the Roman law which ruled the world. Very interesting how this can be a benefit, but it can also be, at the worst, horribly violent. It seems like every Gentile empire is famous. It doesn't take much scratching or research to find out that they were incredibly violent, that people by the thousands and the millions died. That's the story of empires. One of the great empires was the Mongol, Genghis Khan, 1200, not that long ago, 1200. And he took over all of Asia down into India and was coming against European countries. It is said, it has been computed by some experts out there, that the Mongol Empire killed 11% of the Earth's population. That's a big wow. Why did they do that? To exercise dominant control. I ran across an interesting story that I just didn't know about. Napoleon, the French Empire, it was spreading all over the world, and towards the end of the 1700s, he is traveling with his armies to get Egypt, and that's where he was stopped in that spread. But he was coming down through the Middle East. He was coming down where we call Israel right now, and there was the city of Joppa. And he took the city of Joppa, very close to where Tel Aviv is right now. And he captured it, and he had 3,000 Muslim Turkish soldiers that were taken captive. And he promised them that they would be saved, that they would be in his prisons and they would be cared for. That was part of the promise of the surrender. And then you hear, look it up. It's the first time I heard of it. He decided that he didn't have the soldiers to guard them, and he didn't want to take the resources and food to feed them. And so he took them out to the beach there and had every one of them killed. That's what happens with empires. You do the expedient thing, and you come up with justifications for doing the expedient thing, and people by the thousands die. Violence and death of millions as empires dominate. We all have heard of what happened in China under Mao, and we've all heard of what happened in Russia, the USSR, with Stalin. Millions of people died because they were thought to be resisting the dominant idea of this empire. All right, it's the day of the Gentiles. It's still the day of the Gentiles. But what about if you're about to be crushed? What about Judah? What about Habakkuk? Is there any consolation for those who are about to be crushed in one of these turnovers of empires? Is there any consolation, anything that you can find some calm and peace, because you're going to be filled with fear? The story of this nation coming towards you is that they're bitter and they're hasty, impulsive, and they'll kill and they'll take. And so is there any consolation? Is there anything you can hang your hat on, anything that can give you strength? And Habakkuk addresses that, I think, in a nice way. I think he does it in two ways. I think there's two forms of consolation I want to bring to your attention. The first one is that Habakkuk, under the Lord's directions, decides to write out a song. You've heard the first stanza in this song. Imagine writing a song that's a taunt song. It's a derisive song. That's in the Bible a couple of times. Various of the prophets were asked to write these. Pull out your outline, would you? Because I want to just go through these woes. And because you might be a little bored with this lesson, I'm gonna ask you every time we come to a woe to say, woe. All right? Do it with some feeling. Woe. Yeah, thank you for practicing. I was almost going to use the word doom, because that's what the word woe means. Let's look at these. He writes a song, a taunting song, with five stanzas. Every one of them begins with the word woe. Woe to you. And he's talking to who? He's talking to Nebuchadnezzar. He's talking to the great king leader of this empire that's coming to crush Judah. And he's saying, I've got some news for you that brings me some sort of consolation to bring you this news. It's sort of the two-way consolation. You're about to crush us, but I want you to know you're going to get crushed. Woe to you. Let's look at these five real quickly. You can see them on your outline. Woe to him who heaps up what is not as long. For how long? And loads up himself with pledges. Because, verse 8, because you have plundered many nations, all the remnant of the people shall plunder you. That's the big principle. Habakkuk knows this is going to happen. You're going to plunder us as you have many nations, Nebuchadnezzar. You're going to suck us dry. You're going to take all the best of who we are, and you're going to take it back to Babylon and celebrate it. But guess what? The same thing is going to happen to you. You are going to be plundered by others. So the first woe is woe. Yeah. Second woe, woe to him who gains for his house to set his nest on high. What's being pictured there is an eagle's nest up high in a tree, safe, secure from all things. And this is a nice nest. This is a great place for him. And so we're supposed to be thinking about this safe, secure fortress that he has, safe from any other violence, from any other people, because he's surrounded by his own. And what does the song say? Woe to him who gets evil gain for his house to set his nest on high and be safe from the rich of harm. You have devised shame for your house by killing many people. You have forfeited your life. The very stone and wall and beam is going to cry out. Justice will happen. The very thing you think is safe, secure house, it's going to be pulled down. And we would all say, woe. Woe number three. What is he saying here? This woe is about Nebuchadnezzar's vanity city. A vanity city is where you say, this is the city of greatness. Look at these buildings I have built. Look at these. Babylon became one of the seven wonders of the ancient world with its hanging gardens. It was famous. People wrote about it. People thought, man, civilization can't get any richer or higher than this. But look at the song. It says, woe to him who builds a town and founds a city on iniquity, on sinfulness. Behold, is it not from the Lord of hosts that people merely labor for fire? What he's basically saying there is, thanks for gathering all the kindling together in your city, because God's going to burn it. This beautiful city that you've made, God's going to burn it down. And we would all say about that, woe. Woe number four, what is this? This is where it gets sick. Unfortunately, with almost every Gentile empire, think through them all, they become eventually so filled with power, so filled with success, that they start to enjoy sadism and cruelty and humiliation of others. Can you imagine that there would be an entertainment venue designed to kill people for the enjoyment of other people? That slaves and others would fight each other to the death, that people would be humiliated in ways, they'd be intoxicated and then stripped nude and paraded, as though that somehow is an indication of our great power and our glory. It's a perversion, it's a corruption that happens in every Gentile empire. Why? Because there's no ruling force that says this is right, this is wrong. You do what is right in your own eyes. He says, woe to him who makes his neighbors drink. You pour out your wrath and make them drunk in order to gaze at their nakedness. And he goes on with that description. But he says, the cup of the Lord's right hand will come upon you, and mutter shame will come upon your glory. That's probably a good translation, mutter shame. But looking it up, there's some who say what that means is you're going to throw up. God's hand of wrath, his cup of wrath is going to come upon you. You're going to drink it, whether you like it or not, Nebuchadnezzar. And then all of these riches that you have swallowed, all of these things that you have done are going to be spewed out. They're going to be thrown up. And we would say, woe. The fifth woe is this whole trust in chariots that we've already thought about today in our scripture reading, that we put our trust in things that we make with our own hands. They may be images of gods. They may be great military forces. They may be all sorts of things like that, but you shouldn't trust in them because they're not awake. They can't help you in your time, and yet we build and we build and we build military. But ultimately, what will save us? It's only the hand of God. And so you'd say all this trust you've put in chariots is futile and foolish. And maybe we would say, woe, doom is coming your way. And so we have the five woes of Habakkuk 2. And my question, that's quite a song, would be, how much consolation do you think the five woes would have brought Habakkuk or the people of Judah? You know, they're taught a song to taunt the people that are coming to crush them. How much consolation do you think that would bring them? Habakkuk knows that every empire that rises also falls and is consumed by the next, so that's going to happen to this empire coming upon them. Habakkuk knows that the Lord of hosts is overseeing and is in the ultimate source of this empire's future doom, and so he can say, whoa, you guys are doomed. Just like you're going to crush us, you will be crushed, and that can provide a certain level of consolation, can't it? It's not a real satisfying one, though. Habakkuk doesn't stop there. He goes on to our last verse. Where else does Habakkuk look for consolation of his grief and his anguish over what's about to happen to Judah? Where does he go with his anger at the wickedness of the approaching cruel Chaldeans, of Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians? I think he goes to this verse, Habakkuk 2:20. Where it's basically saying, wait for the Lord, his kingdom will come. That's his message. That's the message of Habakkuk to his own heart. Yes, they're going to get crushed. They're going to get crushed. They're going to be embarrassed. They're going to be humiliated, just like we were getting crushed and humiliated. All of these empires, one after another, this is what's going to happen to them. Right up until this day, it's still happening. But the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. There's a practice there that I'd like to encourage you to take up. It's right at the end there. Keep silence. I think that's a practice that we can do. Here's what I think the practice is. The practice is put your life into the hands of God. That's hard to do. That's hard to do when you're wrestling with God over what he tells you how to live. You're wrestling with God over what seems to be unfair illness or unfair events that are happening in your life. You're wrestling with God because he's calling you to live a life that you just don't want to live because it's so uncomfortable to live that life, the Christian life in this day and age, where God is calling you to be different from the dominant socioeconomic world that you live in, the time of the Gentiles, to refuse them and instead choose God. What do? You keep silence. It's a practice. It's a volitional practice where you recognize first God is in his holy temple. God exists. He's in his holy temple. It doesn't matter in spite of the fact of all that's happening in my world, but the Lord is in his holy temple, and so I'll worship him. I'll remember the many times where I felt absolute awe over who he is and what he's done in this world. I will remember that. I'll sing about it on Sunday with others. I'll gather with others around the world, around the Word of God, and remember what he's done. And I'll take that deep breath and say, the Lord of all is in his holy temple way beyond. I'm looking up at you, Lord. And then I'll do the practice that all the earth should do. I'll put myself into his hands. Last week, Lee and I had the blessing and the test of taking care of our three grandchildren for the weekend. We passed with flying colors. Only lost it a couple of times. And they only lost it a couple of times. Poor kids, dealing with us old fogies. But yes, it was a wonderful time. And well, interesting event that happens. We went out to eat once, and we went out for walks other times. And I would constantly, okay, hold hands, everybody. Hold my hand. And those little jerks resisted. They didn't want to hold my hand. Maybe it was me. Maybe they were holding Lee's hand, probably holding Lee's hand. She's the tender, loving one. But they wouldn't hold. They were just resisting. And then Monday is the last morning we had them, and we were taking them to school, getting them all packed up, lunches, all that stuff. So glad that's not a part of my life anymore. And so we were getting them all ready, getting them packed out. Sienna, the youngest, going to kindergarten, she has a mini meltdown. The waffle wasn't right. And so we had to look for something else, and finally got some food in her, and we went off to school, and we were parked right across the street from Armstrong, and is it Armstrong? Yeah, right across the street from Armstrong, a low-impact street, and there's cars going by with parents, and so they're aware. But we all unload, and I'm on my own, and little Sienna puts her hand in mine. Why? I think she's still a little intimidated about going to school. I don't think it's a delightful place to her yet. And so she wanted to feel secure. She wanted to feel safe. She wanted to be able to say, this guy loves me, and he's going to take care of me, and I'm all right. At least that's what this grandpa interpreted, all right? It could have been none of that, but I'm pretty sure that's what it meant. She grabbed my hand, and we walked on to the property, and we had to wait, because we were early, because if you're a Scales, you arrive 5 minutes early. You don't arrive late. Okay, 10 minutes early is what we were. And so we were standing out in the semi-cold, and she kept holding my hand, and we talked. And we laughed, and I said hello to people arriving, and she said, why do you say hello to everybody? And I said, because they look at me, and I feel like I should say hello. If you want to practice keeping silence, you put your hand right into God's hand. And you trust him with your very life. And it changes everything, makes you a different person. I believe it's true. You should practice it. Put your hand into God's and trust him with everything. No matter what it is, trust him with everything. All right, we're going to sing a song that I semi-requested because it holds a line right from this passage. The earth is filled with his glory. We're going to end our service praising God, worshiping him, remembering his greatness and his awesomeness. And I hope it stirs your heart so that you will praise him and worship him. And it will do that change that worship does. It'll make you humble before your God and grateful for what he's done for you and willing to, with joyfulness and gladness, serve him. Stand with me. Let's get ready to end with worship. Heavenly Father, thank you for our time here today. Thank you for your word. Thank you for this answer that Habakkuk brings us from you, that you are in your holy temple. and that you're watching us and that you know us and that you see us. Thank you for that message, Heavenly Father, and now help us to keep silence before you, to keep silence, to trust in you, to put our hand into you, to put our lives into your hands. Help us to do that, I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship him now. How great, how awesome is he? Together we sing, yeah, everyone sing. And holy is the Lord God Almighty, and the earth is filled with his glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, yes, the earth is filled with his glory.
Please remain standing. As a response to our message, I want to encourage you to consider giving here at Canyon Creek. This speaks to our heart and helps us to release that control over our lives in the area of finances, and it's a way of reaching our hand out and asking God to hold on to it. We have three ways in which you can do this. The one I'd like to make mention of here in the service is we do have a box in the back. If you do place something inside of that box, it will be picked up today and processed this week. So be aware of that. We also have two boxes in the lobby. They all get checked. And so be aware of that. But you can give online, which is a great place to do consistent giving, and then also have items mailed here to the church. And so be aware of those things. But now let me read a blessing over you as we would close our service and have our benediction. So hear these words from 2 Corinthians 13, verse 11. Finally, brothers and sisters, rejoice. Aim for restoration, comfort one another, agree with one another, live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. So friends, let us leave here encouraged by God's word. Please stay, spend time with us, grab some donuts and coffee, hang out in fellowship. And again, if you are new here, we'd love to meet you, and we'll be up here for a bit. All right, God bless you all. Have a wonderful week.